be glorified, and I really want Satan to be horrified. Into a praise because he died. He did not have to do it. I hear the old saints testifying right now. He didn't have to do it, but he did. But let me tell you something. He had to do it because we needed to be redeemed.
Our presiding prelate, the senior pastor of the North Hope Christian Church of Marion, South Carolina, presiding prelate of the Christian Covenant Fellowship of Ministries, Bishop Dr. Michael A. Blue, Sr. Let's clap our hands and receive you. Bishop Blue. Let us make some noise for the honoree, Overseer L. Andre Person, and Lady Sheldon Person. Come on, let's do it right tonight. We're celebrating tonight. Overseer L. Andre Person, Senior. Lady Shelby Person. Come on, keep those hands together. Don't get tired of clapping. Hallelujah. God bless you. Every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights. Thank you, Father, for this gift of Overseer L. Andre Person. Thank you that in the unrecorded eons of eternity past, you had a plan, you had an intent, and in the fullness of time, you brought this man into the earth, and all of our lives have been enhanced. Our paths have converged, and based upon the numerous testimonies that have been given tonight, we know that you have done all things well. We ask you, oh God, to continue to let your hand of mercy and grace rest on this man of God, upon his wife, upon their children, upon their parents and the extended family, and oh God, upon this new harvest temple, let your glory continue to compound, oh God, and do exceeding abundantly above all that they are able to ask or think. We give you glory now, Lord. Let your blood cover us afresh, wash us from every sin, every impediment. Oh God, thank you for the tongue of the learned, that we may know how to speak a word in season to him that is weary. Thank you for authority over every spirit. Every spirit is brought subject to the word of God, to the Holy Ghost, to the blood, and to the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Be thou exalted, we pray, in Jesus' name. Everybody praise him because he's worthy to be praised. Praise him because he's worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you're glad for the life and ministry of Overseer L. Andre Person, would you join me one more time in giving reverence, giving praise to God, honor to him. Thank God for his yes to God, his surrender, his continual return to the altar. Thank God. For the woman of God who stands at his side, thank God. For First Lady Shelby Percy. And to this entire First family, are we grateful for them? Aren't you grateful for Apostle Person and Mother? Come on, let them know we appreciate them. And to the entire household of faith, to all of the apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, all the bishops, overseers, moderators, elders, ministers, to all of the deacons, mothers, missionaries, to the stewards, stewardesses, to the trustees, to the auxiliary chairpersons, auxiliary members, to our civic official that just spoke, to our most affable and efficient host. Thank God for him. Praise God for Dr. Bond, call him Dr. Hall. And to all of God's great people, because everybody is somebody in the Father's house. Could you just give one another a round of applause? Just before you're seated, just speak a word over someone's life. Speak it over three individuals' lives. Speak it quickly, since our time is so constricted. But say to them, I believe that something good is about to happen to you. And after you've said it over their lives, speak it over your own life. I believe that something good is about to happen to me. Praise God. You may be seated if you will. Thank God. Thank God. Praise the Lord. We're going to the book of Luke, chapter 4, and while we're turning, those who have Bibles and those who are sliding, using various devices, swiping, all of us will go to the book of Luke, chapter 4, and again, we knew that our time was restricted. As much monitor as you can spare, please, and as much high as you can spare. And so we understand that on occasions like these, we're here for what we've done. I said, on occasions like these, we're here for what has taken place. There's a testimonial aspect to this that cannot be aborted, cannot really be truncated, but so much because in doing that, we take away the flavor of the whole purpose as to why we're here. We're here to give testimony. We're here to give witness to the greatness of God in the life of this man of God. And we can't tell it if we don't tell it. Amen. And though we pray and we trust that there will be many happy returns, we won't have this one again. And so we need to give this one all that it's due. Can you say amen? And may I commend you. I realize it's the holiday season and there's so many things that are going on that could have distracted you. So may I commend you for taking the time and making the time to be here to celebrate a dear man of God. You are to be commended. You are to be commended. I can say some things about the overseer. I can talk about how we met and all of those things. But I would just like to quickly mention that the thing that stands out the most in my heart with regard to him is his personal integrity. I see a sincerity and an earnestness about him that I find attractive in the kingdom of God. Are you listening to what I'm saying? It's magnetic, it's charismatic, because unfortunately there is form in many situations, but not very much substance. There's a lot of style, but not a lot of substance. And so when we see form without power, so prevalent, that is such a blessing when we can see someone who not only has the style of ministry, but has the substance of ministry as well. If you agree with that, make a noise, let the preacher know. And sir, so we appreciate you, and had we more time, we certainly have more content that we could share eulogizing you. Somebody said, wait a minute, brother, but he's not dead. No, the word eulogy, the word eulogy means a good word. And we have many more eulogistic expressions that could most appropriately be given while he can hear them, as opposed to the other state. Amen? So in the book of Luke, the Gospel of Luke is where we're going to read. And we have some wonderful men and women whom we love so dearly. We love all of you, but I mean, there are many that we know. And I tell you, it's just a privilege to be in fellowship with you. And whether I was standing to speak or not, just to be in the number is enough. The book of Luke chapter 4, and we'll begin to talk. And again, we know our constriction, so work with us in that we're going to have to cut this very quickly, very shortly. The 16th verse, and he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. It would be wonderful if we could read verse 14, where it says he returned in the power of the Spirit, and there went a fame of him. But verse 16 says, and he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord, etc. And the Bible says in verse 22, and all bearing witness and wondered at the gracious words which were seed out of his mouth. And they said, is not this Joseph's son? And the title of our discussion, our very brief discussion for tonight is Chosen for Change. Everybody say Chosen for Change. And I'm addressing this directly to the man of God that we've come to celebrate tonight, because I believe that God has made choice of him. Even when Apostle gave us the wonderful narrative as to how he came to the point where he needed to appoint him as his successor. But even though it would come across as purely being necessity from a human perspective, it winds up being providential from a divine perspective. In other words, God had a plan. God was intentional. And one of the things that we must understand when I say chosen for change, I'm speaking specifically about God having made choice. And whenever God makes choice of a man, he goes about, or of a woman, he goes about to prepare and to equip that individual. Now, the choosing and the equipping are not identical. Don't let anybody fool you. Sometimes people say, well, now, whom he called, he'll qualify. As long as you know that call and qualify are not the same. Yeah, there are some people who are genuinely called of God, but they didn't stay still long enough for them to be qualified, because call means come here, and they thought call meant go there. But if you find, if you follow the scripture carefully, you'll find that Jesus called disciples and then he sent apostles. You're not ready to be sent anywhere until you've responded to the call. And between the calling and the sending, there is to be a qualifying. And actually, the qualifying never ceases. The 12 apostles never ceased to be the 12 disciples. So in other words, even though you may have a mandate and assignment on your life, there is a perennial and a perpetual learning that should constitute and should characterize all of our walk. We should forever be learning. We should forever be growing. We should ever be inquiring. We should forever be inquisitive concerning the things of God. You show me somebody who has lost their inquisitiveness, who's lost their curiosity concerning the greater things of God, I'll show you somebody backsliding who might not even know it. So it is, my dear brothers and my dear sisters, when God calls, when God selects an individual, he does begin to go about to qualify that individual. And one of the things that he does is that he takes them through diverse tests and trials. And the number 40 speaks to that. This being your 40th year, the number certainly speaks to that, because the number 40 is the number of probation. It is the number of testing. It is the number of proving. It is the number of refining. It is the number of wilderness experiences. It is the consecration number, as it were. Praise God. And the fact that you have come through 40 years to me that you're entering a new phase, having come out of another phase, come out of the old phase. It was after 40 years that they crossed the Jordan and went into the promised land. It was after 40 days that Jesus, the subject of our text, who came out of this wilderness walking, the Bible said, in the power of the Spirit. So the number 40 is substantial in this context. Not only that, but the number 13, don't you ever miss it. The number 13 is a significant kingdom of God number. And even though it does signify curse, you need to follow the curse all the way on its course. The curse has a course. And the Bible lets us know that when God established the nation of Israel, he established the nation of Israel with 12 sons of Jacob. 12 sons of Jacob. One of the sons' name was Joseph. And Joseph, even though he was the 11th son, he was given the right of the firstborn. And so he became the double portion bearer. And because he became the double portion bearer, we got 12 sons, and then we split Joseph in two, and we end up with 13 sons. We pulled Joseph out, and then we put the other two sons in. Now we got 13 tribes. Somebody said 13. I thought there were 12. Well, there are 12 that have the geographical location, but the 13th tribe is Levi. Levi is the priestly tribe. And what God does is that he takes Levi and scatters Levi among the other 12. Why do you scatter Levi among the other 12? Because the priest is the 13th tribe that keeps the curse off the other 12. And you ought to be glad tonight that God has given you a Levite who labors in prayer and then labors in fasting to keep the curse off the other 12. The 13th man is the curse bearer. Go with me, if you will, to the Last Supper, where the Bible says that there are 13 sitting around the table. 12 apostles and Jesus, number 13. And the Bible said, John the Baptist said, behold, the Lamb of God. What is he doing? Take it away. He's the curse bearer. He's the 13th man. And so the curse leaves at number 13. If you don't believe it, you ask Joshua when they went around Jericho. Okay, all right. 13 times. Praise the Lord. They shouted the 13th time, and the wall came down. I thought it was 7 times, Brother Blue. It was 7 days. And it was 1 time for 6 days. And then it was 7 times on the 7th day. But told the 13th, shout, and the walls come down. Could it be? Could it be our new car harvest temple? Could it be that this is the year that the walls come down? Hallelujah. Shake somebody's hand, tell them, I'll take that. Yes! All right, and so it is. 40 is a number of proving, a number of pruning, a number of refinement. Hallelujah, I'm almost done, sir. And so it is, my dear brothers, my dear sisters, Jesus came through his 40. Yes, he did. When we meet him in Luke chapter 4, Jesus has just come through his 40. Yes, 40 days of fasting, 40 days of praying, and 40 days of being attacked by the devil. But when he came out, he was different than he was when he went in. He went in with the Holy Ghost, but he came out with the power of the Holy Ghost. Believe it or not, there's a difference between the person of the Spirit and the power of the Spirit. And there are many of us who are possessed with the person of the Spirit, but have not yet received the power of the Spirit. The person of the Spirit came when you said G-G-G-G-G-G, but the power of the Spirit came when you denied yourself and emptied yourself of yours.
Hallelujah.
and so it is. Jesus has come through his 40, come through his 40, and now he has a special anointing on his life. Now he goes some places where he was not well known, and the Bible said there he became famous. He went to some places where he didn't go to high school. He went to some places that he did not go to convocation with those folk, and there he became famous. But the Bible said then he went back to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I need you to understand that one of the greatest challenges that you'll ever face is to take your anointing back home. One of the greatest challenges that you'll ever face is to take your gift itself back home. Because at home is where everybody knows your business. At home is where everybody remembers your faults. At home, everybody remembers that trial sermon. And they remember how many times you said, praise God, amen, amen, praise God, praise God. They remember how many times you messed up. They remember how many times you had to be corrected. And sometimes the memory of what you used to be obscures the vision of who you presently are. And so sometimes the person that you can reach least is the person who knows you best. I'm not talking about New Harvest now. I'm talking about Jesus. And I'm talking about who else I'm talking about. Whoever else I'm pertaining to. So it is. Jesus goes to Nazareth. He goes to Nazareth as his custom was. He goes to the synagogue on the Sabbath day. Thank God, sir, that you have a custom of being in the house of God. A long-term custom. One of the reasons why it was easy for the saints to receive you and because you have a custom of being in the house of God. You know, there are some settings where the preacher is trying to make his offspring the successor, but the successor does not have a track record in the house of God. And it's not enough for you to be natural kin to the preacher. You got to have the same spirit. So it is. Jesus stands up, and the Bible says it's given to him to read the book of the prophet Isaiah. And Jesus begins to read, and he said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor." Let me tell you two things about the anointing, and maybe I can just give it up right there. The first thing is the definition. The anointing has definition. The anointing has definition. Now, believe it or not, singing and shouting and dancing, these are not the anointing. Thank you. Let me say it again. Singing and shouting and dancing are not the anointing. They may give evidence that the anointing is present, but they in and of themselves are not anointing. The title of the lesson is Chosen for Change. One of the challenges with some who sing and dance and shout is that they say that they are anointed, but you never see any change occur in their lives. The word anoint from the Hebrew is masak, from which we get our term masiach, or messiah. It means that there's an ointment that is poured, smeared, and rubbed. Poured out, smeared over, and rubbed in. Thank you, sir. Whenever you're anointed by God, he'll pour his spirit upon you, and then he'll cover every aspect of your being, and then he'll roll God. Then he'll apply intensity until what's on you gets in you. Thank you, sir. And the Greek equivalent is Christ, from which we get the term Christ or the anointed one. You know this story. You know this. So when an individual is anointed, it means that the Holy Ghost has come to set upon that individual to empower him or her to do supernaturally that which he or she cannot do naturally. I submit to you, L. Andre Person.
person that is not just because you sing, shout, and dance, but because the Holy Ghost has come upon you. You have been supernaturally empowered to do that which apart from God you could not do, and apart from you God will not do. Anointing is an exchange. Say, anointing is an exchange. The anointing enables you to do that which apart from God you cannot, and which apart from you he will not. Thank you, sir. The anointing is God's energy enabling you to do that which you can't do. It is the energy of God that caused Samson to rip gates off buildings. It's the anointing of God that caused David to say, by my God, I can run through a troop. By my God, I can leap over a wall. It's the anointing that causes Solomon to be able to tell the Queen of Sheba all the desires of her heart. It's the anointing that enables Elisha to tell the king what the enemy is talking about in their bedchamber. Somebody say, it is the anointing of God. Thank you, sir. But now, not only does anointing have a definition, I'm closing right here, but anointing has a demographic. Thank you, sir. Anointing has a demographic. In other words, anointing is a sign to a people. Whenever God anoints a man, he gives that man an assignment, and that assignment is to manage a system while ministering to a people. Don't get it twisted. There's a difference between management and leadership. He wants you to manage a system and lead a people. Can you say yes, Lord? And when a man or a woman is anointed, hold it right there, but keep the key. When a man or woman is anointed, thank you, sir, there is a demographic that is assigned. In other words, there is a people that need a move of God. There is a people that need transformation in their lives. And so God will raise up a man, or raise up a woman who will be the agent of change. We read it in the book of Luke chapter 4 when Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord, come on and get this, Bishop. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Look at what he said. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captive, to proclaim the opening of the prison to them that are bruised, the opening of the eyes to the blind, and to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. We've got the poor, we've got the brokenhearted, we've got the bruised, we've got the blind, and all of them are part of the demographic to whom Jesus is anointed and sent unto. I want to tell you something, New Harvest. There is a new harvest that's about to hit this man's life. There is a new harvest that's about to hit his ministry. And I need you to understand that even though it's been nice serving you, what God is really doing is getting you ready for a new harvest. Can you say yes, Lord? That's what all the fasting is about. That's what all the praying is about. Because God has chosen this man to usher a demographic into change. Would you shake somebody's hand and tell them your praying is not just religious exercise. Your fasting is not just religious ritual. But God has chosen you to usher people into change. Now, I don't know who they are, and I don't know where they're coming from, but I want to say to New Harvest, don't do like Nazareth and miss your visitation because he's always been here. Can you say yes, Lord? Make sure that whenever God begin to usher him and usher you into the new thing, you don't push back on it. You don't say, we never did it this way. We never saw it this way. We never heard it this way. Because I heard the word say, behold, said, I'm going to make a way, even in the wilderness. I want you to shake somebody's hand and hold it for a moment and say after me, one of the great griefs of any leader is to have a vision that he can't reach for, because those that are connected won't flex when he tries to reach. Hallelujah. We're happy with our 300. We're happy with our 500. When God says eyes haven't seen, ears haven't heard, neither have it entered into the hearts of man, it's not enough to admire him. It's not enough to be his fan club. It's not enough to pat him on the back. But it's time to emulate. It's time to be disciples. Can you say it's Lord? And if God moves him, you gotta move with him. As God elevates him in the spirit, you gotta be elevated with him. The musical helps now, because some may not be able to receive it otherwise. Would you shake somebody's hand and tell them, oh, brother, there is an anointing on this overseer. But it's not an anointing for show. It's not just an anointing for dancing. But he's chosen for change. Say he's chosen for change. You didn't know it all, but God has revealed it to you. If God had needed another apostle person, he wouldn't have moved you. Hallelujah. But God shifted you, because this man is anointed for change. Say yeah. When I say change, I don't mean lose holiness. When I say change, I don't mean leave the doctrine. But when I say change, he said the harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Say yes. Shake somebody's hand and tell them this man was chosen for change. Say yes. Listen to me, overseer. The Bible said when Jesus got through reading, everybody said, that's nice. I like that. But when Jesus began to tell them the full implication of his reading, they said, wait a minute. Ain't that your boy? Somebody be careful. Don't you try to size him up based on the fact that you remember when he was a teenager. Based on the fact that you remember when he was in grade school. Because he's not the little boy that he used to be. He's not the little preacher that he used to be. There's a new thing that's been birthed in him. There's a new anointing that rests on him. There's a new vision is upon his life. Can you say yes? Yeah. And the Bible said that in Nazareth he could do no mighty works. Say yes. Yeah. And the Bible said he wound up leaving Nazareth and going down to Capernaum. Say yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
This preacher's not going to leave him in the natural. But what we don't want to happen is for him to leave you in the spirit. You don't want him to outgrow you, but as he goes, so will I go. As he prays, so will I pray. As he fasts, so will I fast. Say yes. I close this. You remember the Bible teaches us that Jesus was born in Bethlehem. He did great work in Capernaum. He died, was buried and rose again in Jerusalem. But Nazareth, what's the significance of Nazareth? Bethlehem is the house of bread. Jerusalem is the city of peace. But what about Nazareth? What's the significance of Nazareth? And I found out that the definition of Nazareth is a very simple one. It is the place of the branch
What's the significance of the place on the brain? It means it is the place where I grew. It is the place where God made me. Say yes. The woman with issue of blood was healed in Capernaum. Jairus' daughter was raised from the dead in Capernaum. But in Nazareth, no names are called. In Nazareth, no mighty miracles. But Nazareth became the launching pad. Nazareth became the launching pad.
Jesus Christ, and so overseer, I say to you, sir.
Yes, sir.
The anointing.
Yes, sir.
That many sins that have testified to tonight is not so that you can maintain the status quo, but you have been chosen to usher a people into what the Bible calls metamorphosis. You familiar? Romans 12, 2, what it say? Be not conformed to this world, but be metamorphosized.
Transformed.
What the Greek is there? By the renewing of your mind. I suspect that if New Harvest told the whole story, they will tell you that in the most recent few years, this preacher has challenged them.
Yes.
No, Harvest, am I telling you?
Yes, sir.
He's challenged you to go deeper in your walk with God. He's challenged you to study the Word of God with fresh eyes. And he's challenged you to see the kingdom of God as more than a futuristic destination. But that the kingdom of God also has a present dimension.
That's it.
Would you agree with that?
Yes, sir.
I want you to point your hands toward the preacher. This preacher, this pastor, he's been chosen, anointed to usher the people into change.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Let us lift him and not limit him. Overseer, there are new doors of utterance that the Father is going to entrust into your hands. It does not mean by any stretch that the old doors are obsolete. That's not what I'm saying. But after this period of probation, now God, having set his approval on you as one whom he can trust, is going to open new doors. And not only new church doors, but unconventional doors. Because your heart and your mind have been prepared that you can walk in unconventional settings and not become unsanctified. Hallelujah. And so I speak over your eyes that you will see with fresh vision. I speak over your mouth that you will have the tongue of the learned. Yes. And I speak over your hands that the healing virtue of Jesus will flow out of you the more. And certainly we speak over your heart and mind that they will be pure, that they will be preserved for God's glory only. We pray over your family and all the works of your hands. We pray for increase on every side. Material increase, financial increase, staffing increase, personnel increase. In the name of Jesus, saints, point your hands for the next 30 seconds. If you believe that your man has been chosen for change, I want you to pray over his life that everything he stands in need of to perform the work of God that had come to his nomination. Pray it right now. Come on, Lord Thomas. Thank you that you chose to usher nation, usher tribes into change. You give me glory. Lift your voice and shout unto God. Lift your voice and shout unto God. Bless the Lord. Let's bless the Lord, everybody. Thank God for that word. I was grabbing that too. I said, Me too, Lord. Bishop Blue has blessed the house. Bishop Blue has blessed the house tonight. Let's thank God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
All the glory, all the praise. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. The Lord has blessed us. The Lord has done so much in these last few hours. We appreciate all of you. Just want to thank all of you. I didn't get around to everybody's table. Been fighting something for the last week. In my body, I said, try to rest up today just to do what I'm doing. And I tell you, I'm grateful for those that come from far, from near. South Carolina, North Carolina, Virginia, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, wherever you come from. You come to worship us. Presence is here. I really don't have a lot to say. I really can't say what I want to say, based on my voice. And I just want to appreciate all of you. And thank you, because you made this night to be what it is. I know our time has went over, but I dare not stifle the presence of God. So if anything we're going to do, we're going to use these next few moments to give God glory and give him praise. Come on, Zion, lift your voice. Lift your voice, Zion. Lift your voice. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Anniversary committee, they didn't get a chance to come present, but we thank God for them tonight, just doing what y'all do. Thank y'all so much. Amen. Boy, I give God praise for one of the best churches on this side of heaven, New Harvest Temple. Thank you all so much, and I must give God praise for my brother, my sister-in-law, Cheryl. I'm glad she didn't get a chance to speak to you, but she brought up that tambourine. I needed that tambourine. Come on out. Bring the praise wherever we are. When she turned 50, we got a chance to dance on the dance floor. And so I praise God. She took me on my first dream ride on Scepter. And I never forget it. I'm saying all that to say I thank God for my sister, my nieces and nephews, my children, my wife. Let's give God praise. She's been working behind the scenes, doing things and pushing. And thank you so much for your push. Thank you so much for your support. And thank you for the children. I appreciate you. I love you. Thank you so much. I want to keep praying for her mom and dad. They would have been here, was supposed to be here. Mom was taken to the hospital yesterday, transferred from Willingboro to Philly to that hospital. We are praying healing for her, Pop and all dealing with bronchitis, this situation. Let's continue to pray for them. We're grateful tonight. Pray for tonight. Thank God for my parents being here. Certainly, we gotta give God praise for them. What they started in the biological, what they picked up in the spiritual. I appreciate you because not only the physical, but also sort of spiritual. We would not be the church we are without your sacrifice from the very beginning. It's in their house. Where they started, I wasn't even nowhere near. But God had a soul that they started the church. Mother started having prayer meeting in our old house in Southwest Philly, West Philly. Just thank God for what it's come to. New Harvest, we're indebted to them into eternity. We'll never forget it. We want to appreciate them. They're just them. They ain't gonna be nobody else. Just them. I learned to embrace these moments because we don't know how things shift so swiftly. So all of you, time, step out. Time is all the way from North Carolina. But he's back there. One of my buddies from an old fellowship and organization. All the pastors. Brother Darnell Harris in the back. Thank you. Appreciate him and just all of you. I can go around to each person at each table. Tell me how much I appreciate y'all so very much. I am what I am because of you and the support of your prayers. I don't have much of a voice left, but let's give God one more praise. Thank God for Dr. Kevin Dine, who has been a friend to us and brother. We thank God for our regional bishop being here. Bishop Wesley. I get to serve these great men, God, to the preacher for this event, and my pastor, my mentor, my father in the gospel. I'm so glad that my father takes nothing away from him and he feels no type of way. He endorses the fatherhood of Bishop Michael Blue, and it gives me pleasure to serve him. We had a brief moment to talk with Pastor Melinda earlier, and she gave her salutations as well, but we're praying for her. She lost her sister on Wednesday evening, so we ask you to keep the family in prayer. As Bishop still could have rushed back home, could have done a lot of things, but God had it so that he was here to speak into our lives. I don't think that word was just for me. I'm taking it definitely, but I believe it was for all of us. And if you really understand, there is another glory shift that has happened. So much has been confirmed by not just one, not by just two, but so much has been confirmed tonight. We appreciate. We thank God for my brother, Rasheen Shabri, his awesome band, I don't even know their names, but they're here and plead for us that we can dance on this dance floor. Amen. We praise God for you. We praise God for the sound engineers, the decibel group, Brother Brister, who is a silent storm in Philadelphia. He's a musician. He knows what he's doing. And I appreciate him. Brother Charles Lundy, who is our brother as well. And Brother Elliot, Robert Elliot. They're all our friends and our brothers. It's just good that they could be here and supply our sound tonight. Come on, let's give God praise for them. All of you that participated, those that sold tickets, got tickets, thank you all, those, everybody, thank you. I'm trying to get all of this out. I want to thank you all. Thank you all. I didn't come in using praise. Praise the Lord. That's all right. Amen. And I just thank the committee again for some awesome time. They took what I wanted and ran with it. And thank you for being a committee that listens to your pastor and try to do your best to do what pastor acts or even desires, even in this event. Thank you so much, all of you. Let's give that committee a hand, please. Like I said, I could go around at each table and say things all day. As it was forestated, Pastor Karen Johnson couldn't be here. And we're yet praying because we know what this time is for her. And she had an opportunity to be in our conference in Florence this past summer. But we know where she's at now and this weekend, so we're praying for her. Is there anything else to do? Let's stand.